Good morning, LSA, and welcome to church. Many of you have taken advantage of our community groups already and participated in our Multiply study. Well, we are now transitioning back into sermon-based studies. If you're not already in a small group, why don't you be all in with LSA and talk to Deb today, or fill out the form online. We also want to inform you that our annual general meeting is coming up on May 1st after the service. Annual reports have been emailed out to members and physical copies are also available. If you need one, just let us know and we will get a copy to you as soon as we can.
Mother's Day will be here soon and we are having a baby dedication. If you want to dedicate your child, contact Deb Toth today. Also, Connie is running primetime this Wednesday. So if you are 50 plus, make sure you join us this Wednesday for a time of worship, teaching, and fellowship. If you have any questions, you can go to our website, lsa.church. And now, let's continue with our morning service.
Great to be together again, especially in one service. I really like that a lot. Anyways, join us in worship on this next song, Build My Life.
Worthy of
myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty? Be still and know you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak.
Good morning.
So good to see everyone this morning, to be worshiping God, to be able to raise up his name, to be able to sing those, you know, those, that song that we sang at the end. It's one of my favorite songs, and probably because I talk so much, that the idea of just being silent, that I don't need to say anything to really bring glory to God. I can just be. I can just give my spirit over to him, and that is enough. And I would say that to everybody here this morning. God isn't looking for your actions. God isn't looking for your words. God is just looking for you as you are. And he's going to take you because it's not our actions that purify us. It's not what we do. It's what God does in us. And so you just have to bring yourself, and God will shape and mold you as you give yourself over to him. And as we come under the authority of his word and we submit to it. And that's what we're really doing this morning. That's the great thing about coming on a Sunday morning is as a group, we're all together in submission. Submission is a scary word in our culture, you know. You always want to be leading, not submitting. And yet here we can come joyfully submitting together under this beautiful word to us. Our sermon series for that we're starting, it's a four-part series, but it's a continuation of a series I started way back in the fall in Romans chapter 1. We did Romans 1, and now we're going to do Romans 2. And this is how it's going to go all the way to the end of Romans. We're going to go through this whole book. It's probably going to take us, I would say probably 2-3 years to go through it. We're just going to do a section at a time. We'll take a chapter, and then we'll move on to something else, and then we'll come back and do the next chapter. So we're on chapter 2, Romans chapter 2, and the title of our series is Humanity, a Living Together Under God's Grace. And the sermon title is No Better, No Worse. And our sermon scripture is Romans chapter 2, verses 1 to 5. Let's read it together now. Therefore, you have no excuse, O man, every one of you who judges. For in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself because you, the judge, practice the very same things. We know that the judgment of God rightly falls on those who practice such things. Do you suppose, O man, you who judge those who practice such things and yet do them yourself, that you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? But because of your hard and impenitent heart, you're storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath when God's righteous judgment will be revealed. Let us pray. Holy God, we sure don't want to have hard hearts. Lord, we want to have soft hearts. And so, Lord, we pray that we would hear this text to us. Lord, that we would hear this not to somebody else, but that you would work powerfully through this word and that you would begin molding and shaping us and again, adding that softening of the spirit so, Lord, that you could continue to do your great work. Lord, just be with us now and guide us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. A few years ago, my family and I went on a winter trip to a resort north of Winnipeg called Hecla Lakeview Resort. Guys, it was beautiful, and it had all sorts of fun things to do in the wintertime, whether it was hiking or snowshoeing to the lighthouse, going swimming in the indoor pool, or enjoying the hot tub or the steam room. But one of the things we had to try was cross-country skiing. Now, you would think there'd be a lot of cross-country skiing in Manitoba since there is so much snow. The problem is it's usually so cold in the winter, it's not very enjoyable. But this weekend was perfect. We had just the right amount of snow, and it was just the right temperature. Now, the boys and I had never done any cross-country skiing before, and unfortunately for us, there were no instructions with these rental skis. So we just picked up the rental skis and tried to figure it out. So there we were. We had the skis on, and then we realized we didn't know where the head of the trail was. So we're in the parking lot with skis on, trying to find where the head of that trail is. And we finally see the trail marker, you know, beside the building. Only one problem. Before we can get to that nicely groomed, soft, snowy trail,
We have to first go down a hill that looks like it's covered in snow, but we realize quickly it's packed solid. Now, wisdom would say, you don't know what you're doing, so take off the skis and walk down the hill. But no, we're adventurous, we're men, we're going to ski down the hill. How hard can it be? I've seen people on YouTube do it. Knowing that whoever goes down the hill first is going to take the brunt of the learning experience, so I send Owen down first. Now, in my defense, he has the best balance and the most experience on apparatus that needs balancing, aka skateboards. So Owen goes down and makes it almost to the end, but at the last minute, falls on his butt, and of course, Brent and I are so concerned for his safety. No, that's not true. Oh, what did we do? We laughed. We laughed pretty hard. So the question, though, was who was next? Well, I can't send my little guy down before me, so I make the attempt. I get like 2 feet, and that'd be generous, 2 feet down the hill, and things go all wrong immediately. And I end up landing flat on my tailbone. Oh, man, did it hurt. Like, I'm 200 plus pounds landing on a bone that is very, very tiny. Now, it wouldn't have been that bad, right? I could have dealt with the pain eventually once I could breathe again. But one problem. Brennan is at the top of the hill laughing his head off. He's probably thinking, after watching Dad laugh at Owen, right, that this is what we do. Let's just say that Dad wasn't happy about being laughed at, and we'll leave it there. You see, it's one thing to be sitting on the top of the hill and seeing someone else fall and you know, laughing and critiquing everything you see. It's a whole other thing when you get on the hill and people are laughing and critiquing you, right? This morning, we're going to talk about the danger of judging others. Obviously, Paul is not saying that we shouldn't judge the actions of someone as right or wrong in line with the word of God or not, since he does that in chapter 1. So to understand what's going on here, we need to get a bit of context so we really can figure out what Paul's trying to do here. All through chapter 1, Paul, you see, is imagining, and we don't learn about this until chapter 2, verse 17, but we can actually read back and understand that Paul is imagining through chapter 1 that there is this Jewish person, one just like him before he was a Christian, judging the Gentiles' actions along with him in chapter 1. The difference between the imaginary Jewish person and Paul was that Paul knew he was a sinner at heart, that he was completely depraved. There was nothing good in him. Well, the imaginary Jew believed they were different from the Gentiles, that they were better people, not because they were actually living better lives, but because they were Jewish people. They had special status before God. Some Jews of that time believed they would be judged by a different standard. Some even believed that no matter how bad they lived, they would still get into heaven because of their parentage. They didn't have to do anything different. They just had to be born into the right family. And so Paul writes this chapter, too, to challenge those kinds of assumptions that there is one standard for thee, but not for me. We've kind of heard that in our world, right? That we get this idea that we're different, that we're special. And here's the thing for today. This applies in this text. Paul is not speaking about Christians in general. He is speaking about the Jewish people. But we need to apply this text to today. And so I think we need to see who this is really reflecting in our culture today. I think we need to come up with an imaginary Christian person, or pretend Christian person might be a better way of saying it. Imagine a person who thinks that they are a very good Christian, very moral, which means that they've been baptized into the right church. They're a member of the right church. They're born into a Christian family. They take the sacraments. They have the right doctrine. They have all these outward actions that look right, and they go, because of those things, I'm better than other people. What Paul is going to show us is that there are that those people are no better off than the Jew who thought they were okay because they were Jewish. Because here's the thing, no one is better Everyone is guilty. But there is a solution. And we're going to read about and hear about that solution at the end of today's sermon. So let's begin by examining this text to discover how, when we think we're better than others, it actually messes us up in our brains. It messes up our correct understanding of judgment. Verses 1 to 2. Have you ever judged somebody by the way that they looked and found out that you were completely wrong in your judgment? Maybe you thought somebody, you met somebody who was really pretty, right? And what we usually think of pretty people, I'm not saying this, I'm saying culture thinks this, not saying I think this. People say someone's really pretty that they must not be smart or they must not be nice, right? The funny thing is those people sometimes will become your very best friends and you find out that they're great people and, you know, they really sacrificed a lot to do well at school, to be smart. Or maybe you see some guy that, you know, is good looking, big and strong, and you go, this guy's on the football team, and what do you immediately think? He's a jerk. You know, you think that's the way he's going to be, your immediate judgment. And therefore, it's strange and crazy when you find out he's actually very kind and compassionate and can't stand football. This is what happens, remember, to Samuel. Samuel is going around, he's looking for a king. And he is looking and saying, in his mind, what does a kingly person look like? And he goes looking for somebody who looks kingly. He realizes that this is a mistake. He's looking at just the outward appearances. It doesn't work. So what does Samuel do? He listens to God's judgment because God sees what's truly in human hearts. The imaginary Jew that Paul is talking to here has the law, and he knows how to live, but also he doesn't live it perfectly. His heart isn't good, but he pretends to be perfect, to be righteous, but it's mere pretense because he still sins. No matter how good he looks, no matter how good he pretends to be, his insides are dark and black. Remember what Jesus said? Jesus said to the Pharisees, who were the best people. He says, you're whitewashed tombs. You look really good on the outside because you've had a new paint job. But on the inside, there's all death and destruction and bad stuff. So whenever this imaginary Jew is judging another and doing it from a place of superiority, he doesn't reveal that he's righteous to God, but that he is self-righteous, which amounts to nothing in the scheme of things, nothing other than his own condemnation. When someone condemns another person to hell, says, that guy, you know, he's evil, he's going to go to hell, he's an awful, terrible person. He's going to go to eternal separation from God. Because, for instance, he lies, he's a liar. He's actually, this kind of self-righteous person's actually condemning himself because he does the same things. He fudges the truth, he doesn't pay all his taxes. And so what he's doing, here's the crazy thing, guys. So you can imagine, you're a self-righteous person, you think you're great, but you know that there's sin in your life, and you're judging somebody else for this. What you're actually doing is judging yourself. God's going to say, I'm going to use the same standard for you. Oh, so that person's bad because they lied, and so I should send them, you think I should condemn them to eternal separation. But you lie, and you've got nothing better in your life. That means I'm sending you there too. That's what Paul's trying to make, the case he's making. So we who are Christians, just like the Jews of Paul's time, have to be so careful of self-righteously judging other people. We should never say to somebody else that they're a sinner from a place of I'm better. What you say is, I've been there, I'm there. I am still broken. I am still a sinner. I am not doing this as if I think I'm better than you. I'm here with you. I am a sinner walking alongside of you. Now, we're going to have a message we're going to hear about that's going to relieve that, but it's not because we're better. There's nothing good in us that we can, you know, celebrate that makes us good. Rather, it's going to be something that Jesus does in us. Jesus says what we need to do is be very careful about judging somebody else for the speck in their eye, right? When we have a log in our own. Now let's compare that to God's judgment. Paul starts off with the word we. You know, he's including himself here. All Jews, all those who have the Old Testament know that God is able to judge both the one in sin and the one who's self-righteously condemning others that are in sin. And if and when God does this, it is the right judgment because it's based on the truth, on what he knows to be the case. God never makes mistakes, never makes a judgment without it being completely justified. Importantly for Paul here, he also doesn't give anybody a free pass because they're a Jew. Or they, you know, or they're Presbyterian, or they're Pentecostal, or they're Anglican, or they're Lutheran, or they're Baptist. There is no free pass because you belong to the right organization. There's no free pass. There's no special thing that's given to you because you're smarter. There's no special thing given to you because you've gone to the right school. Nothing you can do gives you any advantage. He looks at what people, because here's the thing, because God's going to look at what people do, and what he sees us do isn't so good, right? Psalm chapter 96, verse 13, I like this. Let all creation rejoice before the Lord, for he comes. He comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness, that is, he's going to judge them correctly, and he's going to judge them in his faithfulness. Again, he's not going to treat people differently. But since there is no perfectly righteous person or good person, where does that leave us? Specifically, where does it leave the person who pretends they're morally superior to anyone else when in fact they're just as bad as all of the rest of us? It leaves them in big trouble. This is why. Because they're going to find out one day that they've been faking it all along. They've been trusting in something that wasn't real. No matter how good they looked on the outside, they're going to realize they never had a change on the inside. Next, we discover how when we think we're better than others, it messes up a correct understanding of our guilt. Verses 3 to 4. One of the things I hear a lot is, well, I know I'm going to heaven because I'm a good person. Because I do good. Now, of course, doing good is a good thing. You know, people, I'm not putting down doing good. Whether you're a Christian or not, doing good is a good thing. As we should celebrate that. But unfortunately, being good is not the standard for being welcomed into heaven. What is the standard for being welcomed into heaven? It's perfection. Perfection is the standard. Every hypocrite believes somehow that God is going to judge them by a different standard. They're going to say, you know, there's this high standard for everybody else, but you know what? God's going to give me a pass. He's going to overlook the bad things I've done. Here's the thing. God doesn't change his criteria for people who've tried really hard and made fewer mistakes than others. Remember Adam and Eve? How many mistakes did they make? One. They made one mistake. They ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and they were sent out of the Garden of Eden. Not only that, but every human being that's ever lived since then has suffered because of that one mistake. One. Because God can't be in the presence of sin. The problem is that self-righteous people have a real hard time seeing their sin. I would hope that we're not self-righteous people here. I hope LSA is known in our community as... maybe this wouldn't be a great way to be known, but as a bunch of sinners. Wouldn't that be a good thing in some ways to be kind of known for? In a sense, they know it. They know it, and they never come off as if they're better than anybody else. They just love everybody else. And they know that we're all in this, in many ways, all in this together. Remember the conversation between David and Nathan? David and the prophet Nathan. Nathan tells David about this rich man who kills a poor man's pet lamb. Now, this rich man has flocks, you know, thousands of sheep. And this poor man has one. And it's a pet sheep. He loves this sheep. He takes care of this sheep. He feeds the sheep. He loves this little lamb. And this terrible rich man takes this lamb of this poor person, this one man that only has one, and he slaughters it to be able to feed a guest rather than taking one from his own flocks. Listen to what David says and how Nathan responds in 2 Samuel chapter 12, verses 5 to 7. David burned with anger against the man and said to Nathan, "As surely as the Lord lives, the man who did this must die. He must pay for that lamb four times over because he did such a thing and had no pity." Then Nathan said to David, "You are that man." You see, David had many wives, but he took the one wife, Bathsheba, away from the poor man who only had one. The point is, David couldn't see his own sin. He thought he was righteously condemning the rich man who did the terrible thing, not knowing he did the same things. And we're no better than David here. We're David here, right? We're judgmental of others while being relatively soft on ourselves. This is kind of a normal thing to have happen. I think in the counseling world, some counselor's going to correct me after, I think it's called projection. The idea where you notice the problems in others that are the ones that you struggle with the most. Come on, let's be honest, guys. Is that not true? It's true. You got it. I do this. I hate to admit it, but I do this. I all of a sudden will be critiquing somebody, and then God will tap me on the shoulder and be like, "Brian, you do this too. This is you. This is why you notice it." But the problem is, sometimes I give myself a pass. Well, that's just the way I am. I'm working on it. Maybe I should say the same thing for the other person too, right? They're working on it. It's who they are. We give ourselves a pass. God is not happy when we take it easy on ourselves and judge others harshly. The Jew who thinks they'll escape the judgment of God because of their ancestors, or the moralist who thinks they'll escape the judgment of God because they're pretty good, will be in rude awakening on Judgment Day. They discover God will judge them not on a lenient standard, but on the exact same one as everybody else. What they need to do is submit to the truth that they've sinned. This is the first step. That they're guilty and that they're no better than anybody else, and throw themselves on the mercy of God. Verse 4, this is a brilliant thing to do, because here we learn that God is kind. He offers us forbearance, that means tolerance, and he offers us patience. For example, look at the account of Noah and the flood. God could have made a rule at that time that if you sinned, you died. First sin, you die. But instead, what does he do? He has patience, right? He has patience for 120 years while the ark is being built. But notice, after that, after the 120 years, so he's patient, giving us lots of time to repent. They don't repent. They keep doing it no matter what Noah says, no matter what anybody else says. They keep doing it, and finally the flood comes. Judgment does arrive. So how do we live in this kind of situation where God has offered us so much kindness, so much goodness, so much tolerance? What it should do is lead us to repentance of our sinful behavior and the harsh, self-satisfied judgments we've made of others. The last thing we want to do is think that, well, God hasn't judged me up till now, so because he's so loving, kind, and tolerant, and patient, so I should just keep doing what I've been doing in the past. I should just keep doing it and not worry about the future. It's easy for us to make this wrong assumption that just because God judged us one way today, is patient with us, that he hasn't stricken me down, that I must be okay. That what I've done is okay. No, instead, knowing that we are sinners, we should take advantage of today. We have the day we have right now, where God has already shown us patience and great kindness, and get right with God. This is how we avoid presuming or showing contempt for this patience God has for us, this mercy he has on us. It's by agreeing with God that we're guilty and that he needs to transform us. Next, we discover how when we think we're better than others, it messes up a correct understanding of our repentance. Verse 5. If we believe we're good people, that something God says is sinful can be safely ignored, we get ourselves in a lot of trouble. Because where there's no recognition of sin, there's no recognition of a need to repent. And so what happens with those sins when we ignore them? Or we just pretend not to see them? Are they just forgotten by God? Unfortunately, no, they're not forgotten. It says that when we spend a lot of time just looking at others' problems and sins and make much of them, condemning them, but not spending a lot of time on our own and repenting of them and doing something with them, it does something to our heart. It hardens our heart. It's the same thing when we live a life of sin, denying what the Bible says so clearly is wrong. When we live in it long enough, and you'll notice this in your own life, it begins to harden your heart. When we first engage in that sinful behavior, and think back, we all have them, right? So think back to a sin that's plagued you over and over again. It's been in your life. And you think about the first time that you did that. Maybe you can remember back into your memory the first time you did that. And it really made you feel terrible, didn't it? You felt ashamed. It was bad. But as you continued to do it, all of a sudden, it didn't matter so much anymore. You weren't bothered by it to the same degree. That is an example of your heart being hardened. You're being hardened towards this thing. It doesn't bother you anymore. The Greek word for hard is sclerotes, from which we get the medical term sclerosis. Arteriosclerosis refers to hardening of the arteries, right? I would love to say hardening of the heart. Such physical hardening is an ideal picture of the spiritual condition of hearts that have become unresponsive and insensitive to God. Hard hearts mean we're at the point where we can't hear from God anymore. God speaks all the time. But as we become hard, we can't hear. And as a result, we have less and less desire to follow him and to turn to God for forgiveness, meaning we carry the responsibility. Instead of giving the responsibility to God to pay for it, we have to pay for it ourselves. What we need to know is that we're all sinners, that none of us are righteous by God's measurement. So now what? What can a Jew or a good moral person do? They can turn to God, specifically to Jesus Christ. Every single person is a sinner and is lost. And recognizing that fact that there's no one better and there's no one worse than anyone else when it comes to God's perfect judgment is the first step to finding freedom, to finding forgiveness. Anything you've done in your life, God wants to forgive you. All you have to do is admit that what you did was wrong. And then turn to him, and not only you ask for forgiveness, and he'll give it freely, without any conditions. He'll just give it to you. And more than that, he'll help start softening your heart so that it will bother you more in the future, so you can make that change. See, what we learn in the Bible is that the perfect life of Jesus can be credited to our account. So remember I had said, you can't get into heaven, you can't be with God unless you're perfect. The nice thing is Jesus lived the perfect life. And the great thing is that perfect life can be credited to our account. So that when the day of God's righteous judgment comes, we, instead of receiving, having to pay for our sins, receive the reward that Jesus earned by his perfect life. All we have to do is admit that we're bad people, sinful, and then love, believe in, and follow Jesus our Savior. So friends, what we have learned this morning is that thinking we're better than other people, that we have special status with God, messes us up quite a bit and messes up our thinking and the way and takes us away from God. Thinking we're better messes up our judgment, right? And we start noticing the problems in everyone else's life and miss our own. Our understanding of guilt gets messed up and we're quick to point out everybody else's guilt, but again, miss our guilt for sin and therefore we don't repent. Our understanding of repentance gets messed up. Instead of turning to God and making a change, we just keep hardening our hearts towards God. What we need to do is just admit that we've done wrong and not think of ourselves as better or above anybody else, as if we didn't need exactly the same mercy, patience, and tolerance that God gives others. Instead, embrace this truth, knowing that God forgives our sin as we turn to him through Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Holy God, Lord, we are fallen, broken people. Lord, we've made some pretty big mistakes in our lives. Each of us this morning, Lord, we're going to just take this time right now, Lord, to offer you our lives, not just the good parts, but maybe more importantly right now, the bad parts. Lord, we just offer you right now our sin. Lord, and we just say, we're sorry. We're sorry for what we did. We want to live a better life. We want to live a life that brings glory to you. So, Lord, please forgive us for our sin. Forgive us through the perfect life of Jesus. Lord, we just pray that you would do a work in us. Doesn't matter if we're Christians or not this morning. We know that our hearts, in various ways, become hard. And we just pray by the power of the Spirit, Lord, you would do that miraculous transforming work of making it soft, that we could have compassion for other people, even as we follow your command. Lord, knowing we're no better, we're no worse, Lord, and what they need is exactly what we have found, new life in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Perfection. Focus on where you fall short and repent and receive God's wonderful forgiveness. Amen.